AGI, is it getting closer?
In 2025.
Sorry?
In 2025.
AGI in 2025.
That's right.
Wow.
I could now have an agent do a complete task for me, start to finish. Over time, I'll be able to have an agent do a job for me. And that'll actually happen across them sitting in different data centers and different networks. And they'll all be able to talk to each other because we have normalized on machines being able to talk a human language to a computer rather than machines being able to talk machine-to-machine language to a computer, which is API. Yep. So we're moving from APIs to natural interfaces.
And I've heard you talk about robotics as well. That's a new big thing.
Robotics is big. It's going to take a little longer because you need large world models to train robotics for the physicality of the environment. And the problem that we have over there is we just don't have enough data.
Hey everyone, it's David Bumble coming to you from Cisco Live, back with Jeetu. Jeetu, great to have you back on the show.
David, good to see you, man.
I've got a quiz for you.
Yeah.
If you could turn that over. It's a very basic quiz. I think you've answered this before. AI, all the rage, been all over the news like every day. Where are we on the hype cycle, for lack of a better term, with AI? And I want to also talk about agentic AI. Where are we sort of in this?
I think we are in the very early days. So you haven't reached peak of inflated expectations yet.
On both of those.
On AI and agentic AI, is that the question?
Yep.
Pre-agentic, whatever you call that, I think you're probably past the peak.
Yep.
On agentic, you might be before the peak. But I do feel like I think the better graphic is an S-curve, and you'll have multiple intersecting S-curves where every single time you think you're flattening, you'll have another S-curve that takes you up a hype cycle because you will see continued step function improvements on an ongoing basis. So it's not a one thing and then you're done and then there's kind of you have a peak and then a trough and then you get to kind of steady state. But one of the things I was talking about earlier was you have to keep in mind that our cycle from something feeling like magic to something feeling normal to something becoming completely boring has compressed down to a very, very short amount of time. If you think about ChatGPT, that was like magic 2 years ago.
Yep.
Everyone's like, yeah, that's all right.
Now it's boring.
You know, I'm surprised yet in Europe that not as many people are using the operator yet. But once you use it, it just blows your mind at what it can do because you can literally ask it saying, hey, go figure out for me what my girlfriend and I need to do tonight. It is our date night out and we want to eat some food. These are the three cuisines that we're interested in. Find the best restaurant, find us a movie that's a romantic comedy that's playing in a theater near us, and then go make the reservations and come back to me. And then maybe try to see if you can surprise me with a nice after movie, you know, bar that I can go to. And it will literally go do all of that and come back to you. And it might take a couple hours, but that to me is when not just one agent, but multiple agents start working on your behalf, engage with one another, and they don't have to do it because you have to build a whole lot of plumbing. Like one of the challenges that we've had with machine-to-machine communication is you had to think about building that from the ground up.
Yep.
But the thing that's interesting is the world was built for humans and software applications were built for humans. If other software applications can use those software applications without doing a programmatic interface, but actually just doing a human-like interface, every application can talk to every other application without having a set of RESTful services or APIs.
Yep.
And that completely changes everything, right? I mean, the scale proportion of what you can reach is insane. And so I do feel like most people haven't fully grasped the effects of what is happening with, like even in the past few weeks, right? Like the DeepSeek effect, the way I like to call it.
I'm glad you said that because that's one of my questions. What's the DeepSeek effect and the operator effect?
And so the keep operator on going, effect. Sorry. So it's a profound set of changes that are happening that I don't think everyone has fully fathomed what the implications are going to be. But I'll just give you my point of view on this.
Yeah, please. And give us the vision as well. Sorry. So keep on going.
Yeah. And so DeepSeek is going to precipitously lower the cost of training. And as a result of that, what you'll have is many, many more models.
Okay.
And so we were always going to live in a multi-model world, but you know, most people thought, yeah, you might have 10 models, 15 models. Some people even thought, no, these will get consolidated.
Because of the cost.
Well, they'll get consolidated because not too many companies can afford to do this because it used to cost like $3 to $5 billion to train a GPT-4 class model. Now, if you can do it at $6 million, everything changes because not everyone needs to build a GPT-4 class model. Sometimes you need to build something very bespoke that might cost you $100,000. And this notion of chain of reasoning, kind of chain of thought reasoning and distillation and these techniques that you might have that are actually getting to be very interesting. When you run out of publicly available data, when your cost curve goes down, and once you have your cost curve goes down, what's the second thing that happens? You have many, many more models. What does that do? It creates a massive risk exposure for safety and security. Massive, right? Where models by definition are unpredictable. And how can you have these unpredictable things behave predictably in the applications you want to build?
Yep.
You're going to need to have some safety and security guardrails. So that's one effect. That's one kind of outcome of the DeepSeek effect, which is going to be very profound. And it's going to be a massive shift. That'll require innovation around algorithmic red teaming. That'll require innovation around validation of models. That'll require innovation on how you secure AI itself, all of those pieces. The second thing, which you call the, you know, what we call the operator effect. What's happening with the operator effect? Well, I could now have an agent do a complete task for me, start to finish. Over time, I'll have, be able to have an agent do a job for me. I'll have multiple agents be able to coordinate with each other so that they can do multiple tasks and multiple jobs for me. And that'll actually happen across them sitting in different data centers and different networks. And they'll all be able to talk to each other because we have normalized on machines being able to talk a human language to a computer rather than machines being able to talk machine-to-machine language to a computer, which is API. Yep. So we're moving from APIs to natural interfaces.
Interesting. Between, and that's app to Apple.
App computer. To app, right? So I can, one agent can go to another agent and say, hey, I'm looking for a movie. Can you find a restaurant?
Yeah.
Make sure that those two are close to each other. What's a movie that's close to a restaurant so that the commute time doesn't kill us and we are able to make it from the movie to the restaurant?
Yep.
Wow, that's pretty cool.
Yep.
Right? When that starts happening, what you'll see is then infrastructure required. So right now, when the cost curve goes down, the compute demand, there's a theory, there's at least one theory that one could subscribe to that says maybe the compute demand is not going to be as scarce as it is right now on training.
Okay.
But once your training might go down, but if you have an operator effect and even things like deep research that OpenAI has launched and all of that, the next thing that happens is your inference volume, especially with what they call test time compute, goes up dramatically. And what is test time compute? Test time compute is when an agent says, okay, what kind of food do I want to eat? You ask an agent tonight.
Yep.
Can you get me a restaurant? Or what kind of movie do I want to watch? Show me a movie where I can take my teenage daughter to. And it goes out and picks a movie, but then it self-reflects and says, is this the right answer or not? So it doesn't just give you the answer. It then iterates on that answer and reflects and ruminates on that answer. That rumination period uses compute resources to say, is this going to get iterated on? And that iteration, it happens in this thing called test time compute, right? Which is a form of inferencing. And when that happens, what goes on is your volume of inferencing is going to go up quite a bit. Now, when the volume goes up that much, you're going to have a very different set of networking and infrastructure requirements than what you have today, because you have all these agents that are going to join you and augment you in the workforce. So imagine if you had 1,000 people in the workforce using applications. Now imagine if you had 10,000 people using the applications. You're clearly going to use more bandwidth.
Yep.
And as you use more bandwidth because of the operator effect, you're going to see a massive upsurge of demand signal.
So that's demand on networking, demand on servers, demand on
everything,
storage,
compute, networking,
security,
storage,
then.
You will have. And then I think we are running out of publicly available data in the internet. So, but there's 150 times more data available in someone's organization. And not just one organization, but in aggregate, all the companies. And so while we're running out of publicly available data, these models are going to get trained on more bespoke data to make it much more contextual. I can now get trained on my company's vocabulary. I can understand a very specific question I might ask the model about my company, and it would know it that was not published on the open internet. And that changes everything. You know, that changes the requirements and demand for infrastructure. It changes how you're going to go out and make sure that you infuse security into the fabric of the network.
Yep.
And I think it's going to have profound implications in the world, but it's also going to have, Cisco is at the center of both of these movements. You know, and if you think about DeepSeek effect, it's not just about DeepSeek. People will stop talking about DeepSeek in a few weeks. But the fact that the models will have gotten catalyzed and multiplied at exponential capacity is going to have a fundamental and foundational effect on what the security and safety implications are going to be. So Cisco is at the center of both of these movements. And I think there's probably, in my mind, never been a more exciting time for a company like Cisco in the history of, in the 40-year history that we've been around. Like, I can't think of a time that would be more relevant than this one.
AGI, is it getting closer?
In 2025.
Sorry?
In 2025.
AGI in 2025.
That's right. Wow. You will have cognitive capacity of a human with AI in certain fields in 2025.
And I've heard you talk about robotics as well. That's a new big thing.
Robotics is big. It's going to take a little longer because you need large world models to train robotics for the physicality of the environment. And the problem that we have over there is we just don't have enough data, because the beauty with large language models was you had the internet to train it on. You just don't have enough data on the physical models. And you have to make sure that you use that data, program interfaces for doing certain jobs, program robotics for doing certain jobs. So I think there's a lot of progress being made on robotics. I'm hoping there's going to be a breakthrough where you don't need that much data. But right now, if you talk to someone like Fei-Fei Li, who was at the AI summit, she'll tell you it's going to be hard with robotics to get that in the short term. It's going to be a mid to long term thing. But I think it'll happen gradually, and then there'll be step functions, you know, of innovation.
What's your advice to people who are worried because they see the Terminator videos or movie, they see their jobs getting taken away, they see AI as something that's going to take away stuff from them, perhaps their privacy, robots will become a problem. What do you say to that?
I say that your bigger risk is going to be in the short term. Look, it might very well happen that your job might be taken away, but you have to keep finding new ways to adapt, firstly. Yep. And worrying doesn't help. Learn.
Yeah, I like
that. It's a better way to do it than worrying. And learn how to operate in the new world and think ahead. And then the other thing that I would say is your bigger risk is not whether an AI will take your job in the short term. It's whether someone who uses AI better than you takes your job. And so keep that in mind.
Short term, agentic AI is where I should focus, perhaps, if I was looking for advice. Long term, AI is a great area to focus.
I wouldn't limit just to agentic AI. I think there's so many dimensions with AI. And what use, I would think about the problems you want to solve where AI is an aid and a tool to help solve the problems. What are the most important problems in the world? AI is not at the point yet to define what the problems are that we need to solve. Pick the most important problems that you think would be really important to solve, that you would have a unique perspective in solving, and then use AI to help you solve those problems, and magic will start happening.
So lots happening.
Lots happening.
You said on stage, you know, things are going very, very busy. You've also got a new role.
Yeah, you know, we consolidated the product organization under one group about 6 months ago now. And so Chuck asked me to see if I'd run all the product, and it was it's such an honor and a privilege. This is an iconic company, running product for an iconic company like this that's part of history, and seeing if we can actually really have it shape the next level of history is super exciting. So
what do you see as your main job or role in the new role?
Building amazing products that people love, that they can talk to their friends and family about, that shape the future of humanity.
During the keynote, you mentioned there were three parts to that. So that was one of them. What are the other two?
What we're trying to do right now is we have a core set of principles that we want to make sure that are completely embedded in the ethos of every engineer, every product manager, every designer, every researcher at Cisco. One of them is build products people love. The second one is quality should be priority zero, because I don't want to talk about quality. The only way you can not talk about quality is it never is an issue. And so you have to focus on it a lot up front to make sure that it becomes such a muscle memory dimension that you don't have to ever talk about it. And then the third thing is making sure that you build something that's asymmetric to the market, not just try to catch up. Because especially if you're trying to take share from others, 10% better doesn't get you to take share.
Yep.
Because most people will be like, you know what, it's too much effort for me to switch over for 10%.
Yep.
But 10x better makes it irresponsible for our customers to ignore us. And you want to create a state of irresponsibility for customers to ignore you. And that only happens when something is so compelling. It's like, I got to take a look at this. Like, how can I not take a look at it? I'd look stupid if I didn't take a look at it.
Yep.
And you want to create that state, which requires that you have to keep kind of pushing the bar up on what you build for the market.
I mean, you've taken over the networking portion as well.
Mm-hmm.
Huge business. I'm glad to see that, you know, networking, security, AI, all of these parts are coming together and hopefully will be more aligned.
Yeah. So, you know, the biggest advantage of Cisco is the breadth of capability and the depth of capability we have. But that advantage doesn't get fully realized if it doesn't work harmoniously well together. If you run each one of the things as silos, then you're entering into 1,000 knife fights with people. And that's not interesting. But if you can make sure that you create an integrated, harmonious platform, it makes it feel like you're creating a symphony.
I think it's amazing for networking people as well, because there was a time when networking kind of got boring and perhaps stale, some people felt. But like, this has changed everything in the data center.
Everything in the network. It is, like, I kind of pinch myself going, wow, I took over the networking team and like everything changed. And talk about, like, I'd like to think it's my genius, but no, it's luck. Like, this is the best time to be alive in networking. This is the best time to be alive in security. And this is the best time to be alive in tech, because you're going to be able to do things that we have not even been able to scratch the surface of our imagination with. So let me give you an example. Right now, all of the things that we talk about are very linear thinking.
Yep.
How many jobs is AI going to take?
Yep.
That's a very linear way to think. It's like, okay, I'm going to only have the machine do the jobs that humans are doing.
Yeah.
Interesting, but not super consequential. What's consequential is, what things were humans not able to do? What original insights can you actually have these AI models be able to deliver to us that completely change everything, right? And now if you can change every single assumption that you had about what was going on, say, now, find me a new way to cure cancer.
Yeah.
That humans could not have fathomed, because there are certain things humans are good at. There are certain things humans are not so good at.
Sure.
And the things that humans are not so good at, if you can actually have AI do those, that's actually really good. And then do the things, like one of my mentors had told me at one point in time, what are the things you're really good at? What are the things you love to do? That becomes a first column that you need to keep an inventory of. But then, and I asked him, I'm like, hey, give me some career advice early in my career. And he said, Jeetu, I know I'm wrong at a lot of things, but this one I'm right at. This is Joe Tucci, who was a chairman of EMC, had told me this. Take a sheet of paper, make four columns. What are people good at? What are you good at? What are you personally good at? And what are you really good at doing? That's the first list. Then make a list of what are you good at that you don't really like doing?
Yeah.
That's the second. Then he's like, then make a list of what are you not so good at that you suck at?
Yep.
That you love doing? And fourth one is, what do you hate doing that you suck at? I'm like, okay, I'll make that list. And he said, be intellectually honest. Don't go out and do it just because people want to hear it. Like, be intellectually honest. Like, do you genuinely love managing people, or that's not your passion? You love going out and doing something else. And just put it there, because you don't have to lie to yourself about this. This is only for you. I'm like, all right, so you do that. And he's like, now, after you've done that, take columns 2, 3, and 4 and throw them out the window. Because all that matters is, what are you good at that you love doing?
I love that.
Focus on that, and everything else, get someone else to do it for you. Guess what? If I were to do that and focus on that, what am I really good at? And what do I love doing? And I'm going to keep doing that because I can add value. I'm going to be the world's best at that. And yes, in some of those cases, AI might be better than me. In some cases, I'm going to be better than the AI.
To get the AI to do, or someone else to do those other three.
Other three, but then there's a fifth column. What can I physically just not do because of my human limits?
Yeah.
It's not even because I'm a smart guy or not a smart guy. What can I not do as a human? Or now can AI do that?
Yeah.
And what does that allow me to solve as a problem that I've not been able to even imagine solving up until now? That's mind-bending.
Jeetu, I could keep you here for a long time, but I'm getting told that we have to end it. Thanks so much for
giving
us
David.
Of your time.
It's always a pleasure, man.
Appreciate it, man.
Take care.